Paul Waggoner. I play in a band called Between the Grave and Me. We're absolutely massive in the States. Okay. that's my gig. I'm here on behalf of Ibanez Guitars. Obviously, I want to thank them and Fair Deal and Headstock for having me out here. I'm going to play a few songs, and then I'm going to talk to you about this magnificent instrument that I'm holding, and hopefully each one of you will buy one. Okay, maybe two. Get one of each model. Is that good? Japanese guys think they like that idea. So let me jam a couple songs, and like I said, we'll talk about the guitar, take some questions about the guitar, play a few more songs, and then we'll, I don't know, wrestle or something. I don't know. Q&A or something. All right, so let's do it. Ready over there?
Cool.
All right, let's party. This song is called What Will I Play? I think I'll play, start with Memory Palace. Okay, this one's called Memory Palace so far. New record.
Yeah.
Thank you.
new-ish songs from an album called Coma Ecliptic. It's been out for about a year. When you buy your Ibanez guitar, maybe you should also buy that. As you can see, we use quite a different, you know, pretty wide array of sounds in our music, and you'll hear some more of it a little later. But when I started working with Ibanez on designing this guitar, at the forefront of my mind was I need something that's extremely versatile, something that's going to work for a wide variety of sounds, from heavy metal to sort of more dynamic, clean parts, parts that had a lot of effects on them, delay parts, things like that. Something that was that was a good heavy metal guitar, but still had a little bit of articulation to it, a little clarity to it, even with the heavy, high gain stuff. I wanted to be able to hear the notes. So, and also I wanted it to look really cool. So, I started thinking, man, you know, I've never had an ash guitar. I've always owned, you know, mahogany guitars with a maple top on them. I've never had an ash guitar, and I always loved the look of them. I think it's a really beautiful wood. I mean, even with this guitar, which is, this is my guitar, and I've played the heck out of it, so it's a little bit beat up, but it's a beautiful wood. I love the grains. Every piece looks different. Ash just has a certain character to it aesthetically that I really love. So I said, let's make an ash body guitar. And growing up as a youngster, which was many years ago, I loved the S series, the Ibanez S series. I loved those guitars. And I remember seeing one when I was 17 years old, which was 20 years ago. You can do the math and tell how old I am. But I saw it hanging up in a music store. It was an S, and it had a natural finish, and I bought it. It probably took every dollar that I had to my name, but I bought that guitar, and I've been in love with that model ever since. So I knew I wanted to base it on the S series guitar, and I knew I wanted to see how an ash body would look and sound. So so we started working on it. I decided to make it a little bit thicker than the traditional S series, so you can tell it's a bit thicker, and you could compare it. It looks like they have some S guitars over there, but it's a little thicker than an S, but it's extremely light because it's ash is a little lighter in weight than mahogany. So it's a pretty lightweight guitar, which is good because I'm getting old, my back hurts, and I don't want to lug around a big heavy guitar all the time. So so it's a really light wood. It's got as far as the sound, it's got a real crisp brightness to it. Which I like. In my younger days, I liked the dark sound of mahogany, but these days I really like the brightness of this type of wood. It, especially for the type of band we play in, I needed something that was punchy. I don't know how it is in the UK, but in America, bass players always turn up way too loud. I don't know what it is. Any of you guys bass players? He's a bass player. You need to turn down. Turn it down. So for me, I wanted to be able to cut through the mix. You know, I was tired of in heavy metal, a lot of times everything gets lost. Everything gets muddy. The double bass drum, bass guitar, you know, guitars that are tuned down, or 7-string guitars or 8-string guitars. Everything's in the same register, and it tends to sound a little muddy sometimes. So I wanted a guitar that was really punchy sounding, really snappy. And so this wood is great for that. It's a super... it's got a certain brightness to it. It's hard to really explain, but there's a certain brightness to it that I love. And when you plug into an amp, you have a wide range with your EQ. You can add some bass to it. It gives you a lot more headroom. So I really like that. So that worked out. That was lucky because I really chose this wood because I thought it looked cool. But it ended up sounding really cool too. So so that's the body of the guitar. We finished it with just a black oil stain, very thin stain. You can actually feel, I'll let some of you feel, you can actually still feel the grains of the wood, which is cool. You just run your finger along there, you can feel the grain. It's a very thin coat. You have to feel it.
Really?
That's it. No one else can touch it. But, so yeah, it's just a real thin coat. I've always loved guitars where you could admire the wood. I'm not a huge fan of, opaque guitar finishes with a big, thick layer of paint where it just looks like a big hunk of metal or plastic or something. I like to be reminded that this is a piece of wood, so I like to see the grains. And so this is a thin black oil finish. It still looks pretty heavy metal, but kind of classy at the same time. So, which is, that's me, heavy metal, but classy. So, so anyway, yeah, it came out really cool. This particular model that I'm holding is the PWM 10. This one's made in Indonesia. This is actually the lower end model. The higher end model made in Japan is the PWM 100. They're both extremely similar and they're both built very, very well. There's just a few differences between the two, the biggest being price. But there's some differences, so I would just sort of go through those real quick. The body is essentially, you can tell, here's the PWM 100. You can see the finish is a little bit different. So, they're made in different factories, so it's sort of a different finish. They both look very good, they just look different. This one, a big difference with the wood is the neck. This one is a PWM 10, is a three-piece maple, Babinga maple. And you can see the back is not finished with the same stain as the body and the headstock. With the PWM 10, you have a five-piece, you can't tell because this one is finished with the black oil, but you have a five-piece neck, maple Babinga, maple Babinga, maple, five pieces. They're both extremely sturdy. They're both really well-made necks, which is, it's important for a touring band to have a guitar that's, obviously you want it to sound great and look great, but it's got to be durable. It's got to be able to travel up in the mountains and fly on planes and do all these things and still stay in tune, and you want some stability with the neck, which I think is a great thing about Ibanez guitars. They're known for the thin necks and the playability. Everybody loves Ibanez because of they shred, it's a shredder's guitar. But somehow, and I don't know how they do it, some sort of sorcery at the factory, but they make these thin necks, but they're still extremely, extremely durable. And this is a bolt-on neck, so there's nothing really fancy about it. It's just a really well-built neck, and it's extremely stable. I've been flying around every day. I fly, and I pull this guitar out of the case, and it's still in tune, and the neck is not warped one way or the other. It's extremely durable, and that goes for both models. So they're a little different. They feel a little different, but they both play really well. They both have a rosewood fingerboard. They have the offset dot inlays. They both play like an Ibanez guitar. I think it's the Wizard 3 neck profile. So it's a thin neck, not super duper thin, but it's a thin neck, and it's, like I said, it stays incredibly stable. It's almost unbelievable how stable this guitar remains through all types of climates, all types of altitudes. This guitar, almost every time you pull it out of the case, it is in tune, which is actually pretty unbelievable. And I'll be honest, I've played a lot of guitars, and Ibanez is literally the most stable guitar I've ever had. And they're not paying me to say that. I promise you that. It's true. So so those are kind of the main differences as far as the wood goes. You'll see they both have the matching finish on the headstock, which is really cool. And aesthetically, that's basically the difference. You can tell. It's mainly they sort of have a different approach to the way the guitar is finished. Now the fun stuff, or what I think is the fun stuff, is the electronics, the components, right? How the guitar sounds. There is a difference with the bridge. So this one's the Edge, I think it's the Edge 02, I believe, that comes on the Indonesian model. A super nice bridge, extremely stable. You can do all the heavy metal tricks, all the flutters, all the dive bombs, all that stuff. It's going to return to zero, which is why they have zero in the name, Edge Zero. It returns to zero. In other words, it's going to stay in tune. You can do all kinds of wacky stuff with it, and theoretically, you play a nice, lush chord, it's going to sound in tune. This one here, the Japanese model, PWM-100, has a slightly higher end bridge. It has the Low Pro Edge, which was always my favorite bridge on an Ibanez guitar growing up. They call it the Low Pro, meaning low profile, so your tuning screws don't stick up really high. They're sort of out of the way of your hand. That's why they call it the Low Pro. And again, it's designed to be extremely stable. Obviously some of the Ibanez artists that we're all familiar with, Steve Vai, you know, Joe Satriani, these guys, they do a ton of whammy bar work. So you have to have a guitar that can withstand all that stuff and still sound in tune. So these bridges are extremely extremely stable in terms of their ability to return to zero. They stay in tune. You can play an entire set. Sometimes we play an hour and a half and we don't stop playing. So I'm playing the entire time. I maybe have time to tune my guitar twice in the whole set. So that's extremely important to me. With my band, I have to have a quality bridge. The guitar has to stay in tune.
What sort of strings do you use?
Well, yeah, we're going to get to that. Okay. These are monster strings. You've got to be a big, strong man to play these. So, in fact, I'll go ahead and tell you. I use D'Addario strings, and it's sort of a Frankenstein set. So,
are they the new ones or the coated?
They're not the NYXLs. These are just the regular XLs, although I'm tempted to upgrade to the NYXLs, but I'm a creature of habit, so I find something that I like and I generally stick with it. But the guitar comes shipped with in C-sharp standard tuning, which is our tuning, the tuning we use. So it's basically standard tuning down a step and a half. In order to maintain proper intonation with that kind of tuning, you have to use heavier strings. So I think it ships with a set of 12s on there, which is almost like a jazz gauge. It has a big wound 24 third string, so it's, and then I think it goes all the way up to 59. This one, the one I have currently holding, it's a slightly lighter gauge. I have 11s, so we got 11 on high. This is a 15. The third string is a wound 21, okay? And then we have a 32, 42, and a 56. So they're pretty heavy strings for sort of the type of music that we play. But you have to keep in mind, we do tune down a step and a half. So the tension is for me, it's comfortable. But obviously, you know, you can change it however you like, or you can tune it to standard tuning or whatever. For this tuning, I love the wound third. You guys all play guitar. Everybody struggled with that third string never sounding in tune, right? You play a chord and it's always just wah, 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 you always hear that. And that's a huge pet peeve of mine, especially when we're recording. So I find that the wound third, if you tune down to a lower tuning, like a lot of metal bands do these days, the wound third really helps. You lose a little bit of the bendability, I guess, of it, but for intonation-wise, you'll find that it stays in tune all the way up the neck a little bit better than an unwound third string. So that's what that's what I'm using currently. And again, it ships with even slightly heavier string. Again, obviously, you can change all that. And that's another thing about this neck and this bridge that kind of amazes me is its ability to really take on a heavy gauge like this. You know, Ibanez makes a lot of, like, jazz guitars. Just yesterday, I played the new George Benson model, which is, you know, it's a jazz box. And it comes stock with 12s in standard tuning. So the tension on that thing is ridiculous. You can't bend a note. You know, jazz players don't bend notes like against the wall or something. So, but the neck and the bridge are able to withstand that tension. It's really amazing when you think about how much pressure, you know, tension in terms of just weight of tension in between these two points. And for it to stay, you know, for this bridge to stay stable and for this neck to stay stable is pretty amazing, considering how heavy these strings are. So, again, that's a good question, because that's another really amazing thing about these guitars. So obviously, you know, like I said, the bridge is different. They feel pretty much the same, though, and they perform very well, both of them do. You'll also notice I do not have a tone knob. I never used a tone knob in my entire career. Do any of you guys ever use the tone knob on your guitar? You use it all the time. Roll it back a little bit.
Well, I've got this bold custom.
Yeah.
Three pickup.
Okay.
So
depending on what pickup you're playing.
And the deluxe and three bolt Fender.
Okay.
CBS. So there's lots of reasons why.
Of course.
It depends on what music you're playing.
Exactly.
I don't play your kind of music.
No, you don't. Not many people do. But
I appreciate what you just
said. Oh, thank you.
One question I'd like to ask you is,
yeah.
You know, I've never understood this lockdown on the nut.
Oh, this?
Yeah, because when I was playing in the show band, we never had any worries about retuning up, you know. We were up for an hour and a half. And I wondered why you're locking down the nut there and tuning from the bridge.
Good question. Well, this is you know, this is an advancement that came about when floating tremolos became popular. So, you know, these are basically fine tuners, and then you're sort of, these are your coarse tuners, if you will. So, when you restring the guitar and you use these tuners, obviously, to get it in pitch, or relatively close to in pitch, and once you have the string stretched and everything's pretty stable, by locking these nuts, essentially you're just increasing the stability of the tuning. So it renders these useless, right? Everything past the nut is, you're no longer worried about that. You're no longer worried about these getting twisted or whatever. It locks that in place. So your only variable as far as tuning is down here. So if you have, if this bridge is doing what it's supposed to be doing, which is, you know, remaining stable, returning to zero, and staying in tune, all you ever need to do is make these little fine adjustments.
I'm amazed that you say, you know, you can play for a long period of time. And the kind of punishment you're giving your neck, you know, I'm amazed that it still stays in tune. You know, well, it's got to be something.
It truly is amazing. And when you think about how, when you think about the technology and all the parts in these bridges, these Floyd Rose style bridges, it is amazing that they're able to return to that same incredibly specific part. A specific point to remain in tune. So you're right, it is amazing, but this is a key component to that whole system working properly. If you did not have these locked down, you would notice, for one thing, you would notice a different playability of the guitar. The tension would feel different. And then,
well, you tend to use graphite in the notes, so the strings work sometimes.
Yeah, I don't know what this one is made out of. I assume it's graphite, probably.
Graphite.
It is graphite. I'm glad those guys came along. Yeah, so, which is good. You know, sometimes a bad note can affect your tone as well, you know. So these do a good job. But you'll notice if you don't lock these down, the guitar actually plays differently. If you lock these down, you have the right tension. And again, it's absolutely necessary to lock this down for this system to work properly. So hopefully that answered the question, but... yeah, I only have to, in the course of an hour and a half set or something, I only have to make very, very fine adjustments here. I mean, you're talking a matter of, you know, 10 cents or less, really, with the, that it might sway, and that's slamming the heck out of it. Yeah, of course, yeah.
You're answering it the way you're doing.
Yeah, with this much gain, you can mask it in that too a little bit. But, yeah, so that's basically the bridge. I wanted to talk a little bit, so we were talking about the tone knob. I personally never use the tone knob. I don't know, I guess a lot of people do, but now with all these fancy amps, you can have so many different EQs and save them as presets or whatever. I've just never used a tone knob. It always got in my way more than anything, and sometimes I would notice my guitar sounded weird, and I'd be like, oh crap, I accidentally hit the tone knob, you know, and rolled it back or whatever. So. It's just got a single volume knob, and then in place of the tone knob, I put a coil tap switch, which we'll talk about here in a few minutes. And then it's just a three-way toggle for the pickup. So the bottom position is just your bridge pickup. Your middle position is sort of a hybrid of both. And then your up position is just the neck. And so we'll talk about those. The pickups are obviously a key part of this guitar as well. Anybody that plays electric guitar knows that don't have a good pickup, it's not going to sound good. It doesn't matter how nice the guitar is. If your pickups suck, it's not going to sound very good. So I worked with a small company called Mojo Tone out of North Carolina, which I'm sure none of you have heard of. They're a pretty small company, but they're from right down the street where I live, so they're very nice guys and they do great work. So I said, I'm going to work with these guys and try to design some pickups for this guitar. So we actually took the prototype model of this exact guitar, I took it to their factory, and we started working on designing some pickups that sounded great with this guitar. It turned out they sound great in any guitar, but they sound particularly awesome with this guitar. I kind of knew what I wanted with the bridge pickup. I needed something that was hot, that was, you know, sounded good for heavy metal, that sounded, you know, was good for riffing, you know, head fast, you know, riffing. I wanted to be able to hear, you know. So even like with fast kind of metal riffing on the low strings, I still wanted to be able to hear all the notes. You know, I didn't want it to sound super muddy and, you know, sloppy, because that just doesn't sound good. So I knew I wanted a pickup that had a real nice attack to it, something that accented the wood. The wood, again, is a very bright sounding wood, so I wanted something really punchy, and again, to cut through the loud bass players that turn up way too loud. So we went with the ceramic magnet, which if anybody knows anything about the magnets they use in pickup, ceramic gives you more accent on the pick. So it's a sort of a faster response. It's kind of a punchier hit. It's an immediate impact. Okay, so it's not like low output pickups have sort of more of a sag, more emphasis on the warmth of the note as opposed to the attack of the note. This one, the emphasis is with the attack. Okay, but I'll show you in a little bit. It still has a nice balance to it. So this is sort of the guitar the pickup I use for any of my rhythm metal riffing. Okay. What I really loved about the way it came out, and they pretty much dialed this one in like right off the bat, they knew exactly what I wanted. If you play guitar and you play with a lot of gain and you use a pickup, like an active pickup, like an EMG or something like that, you'll notice that sometimes the high strings and the high notes tend to sound really harsh, right? They're super like, they kind of hurt to hear, at least they do for me. I wanted a pickup that, even though it had the nice pick attack, I didn't want it to sound really harsh on high notes. I wanted there to be like a kind of a nice balance with all the strings. So some of you might recognize this little ditty. But for a riff, you know, we play a lot of sort of proggy riffs that have a lot of single note stuff that maybe starts on a low string and then eventually works its way up to a high string. And I wanted something that kind of that sounded balanced and even throughout that whole range as far as pitch. So you can tell, you know, just playing a sort of simple mid-tempo riff like that, to my ears anyway, it all sounded pretty much in balance. When I got to the higher strings, it wasn't all of a sudden like, oh my God, you know, that hurts my ears. So there's a real nice musicality to this pickup. Even though it's a pickup that's designed for heavy metal playing, it's very musical. It sounds good. It even sounds good, like you can play like a kind of a complex chord with this much gain. It's really hard to get that to sound good, but it kind of... Like, you can really still hear all the notes. The low strings don't really drown out the high strings. You know, you can kind of hear everything, even with like a seventh chord or a ninth chord. You can hear everything. You hear all the notes. That's kind of a rare thing. You don't really get that with active pickups, even though they're very compressed and they're designed to sound even. They don't. They lack a certain musicality to them. So that's why I really like this pickup. It's a hot, high-output pickup, but it still retains enough dynamics to where it sounds good. And it sounds, again, I keep using the word, but it sounds musical. It doesn't just sound like heavy metal, you know, fast ripping. There's a certain, the notes sing in a certain way. So that's primarily what I use that pickup for. For the neck pickup, we took a totally different approach. For years, I had a problem with buying pickups that one pickup sounded great. You know, I buy a set of pickups. One pickup sounded great. The other pickup sounded terrible. That was like the bane of my existence for like 15 years. Like, I could not find a neck pickup that sounded good to me. They were always either too bassy, or they sounded good in a certain register, but then when you played up high, it sounded really harsh. For years, I just thought it was me. I was like, why do they just not make a neck pickup that sounds good? So I told these guys, I said, I want a neck pickup that sounds good. Go make one. So we started working with it. Obviously, with a neck pickup, you generally use that for lead guitar playing, for some clean playing, for clean solos, things like that, where you need a little extra warmth. You don't want to accent again. You don't want too much pick attack. You want more of the note. You want a tone that sings a little bit more, has a more vocal quality to it. So we started. We knew we weren't going to be able to use a ceramic magnet. You're not going to be able to get that with a ceramic magnet. Ceramic magnets are punchy. There's a lot of attack. If you imagine a sound wave, it's going to be a really big transient, and then it's going to sort of fade from there. We wanted something that was a little softer with the attack and had a nice ring to the note. So you heard the note and there was a warmth to it. So we went with an Alnico magnet. I believe it's an Alnico 4, 4 or 5, I can't remember. But it's an Alnico magnet. And it really came out great. In spite of it being completely different from this pickup, the two work together like pretty well. So. And it has a real nice, again, it has a nice singing quality. It's really good for sort of, slow lead parts, like for example. That's what I've always wanted with a pickup, a neck pickup, excuse me. I wanted it to be able to breathe for parts like that. I didn't want it to have that really harsh attack and then all of a sudden the note just sort of dies and sounds really clanky or whatever. So with this, it's sort of, you don't hear too much of the pick attack, you hear just enough, and then you hear a nice full-bodied note. Okay, so that's important to me. It also works for, you know, faster playing, and you still get enough clarity there, right? But it's a nice warm sound. It's not harsh on the ears, which is, that's the biggest thing for me. It also sounds really nice for, you know, sort of more tamed down, you know, kind of things. So it sounds good for, you know, kind of more bluesy type playing or whatever, just with a slight distortion, you know, more kind of a boosted, clean lead almost. So it sounds good for that stuff too. It really came out good. I'm happy with it. And both models, both the PWM10 and the PWM100, they both ship with these exact same pickups. So you're getting that pickup, those pickups, regardless of which model you buy. And since each of you are buying both models, I guess it doesn't matter, but you're going to get both. So that's this pickup. The middle position is also quite useful. I primarily use this for clean guitar playing. It's sort of the best of both worlds kind of pickup position. It's great for strumming parts. The reason I like it is you get sort of the warmth of this pickup, but you get kind of a high-end sparkle from this pickup. I call it a sparkle or a sizzle, you know, where you kind of hear the, here's that position. See how that high string pops out a little bit? I like that, because a lot of times with clean guitar playing, when you try to use a neck pickup or even a hybrid pickup, the low strings have a tendency to really drown out the high strings, and you don't get a nice balance with the two pickups. So, or you don't get a balance across the strings. So I use this this pickup position primarily for strumming parts. So like in the I told you we'd talk a little bit about the coil tap switch. It's kind of the last thing we'll talk about before I play some more ridiculous songs. But the coil tap switch, essentially, it splits the coils of these humbuckers so that you can get a sound that essentially simulates a single coil pickup. So a sound similar to a Fender Stratocaster, you know, that sort of spanky, snappy sound, which, you know, a lot of metal bands don't like that sound, but we actually use it a little bit, and I'll play a song in a little bit where I use that sound, and it makes a huge difference in the tone. You know, with the humbucker sound, so when it's down, you're just in humbucker mode, and you can hear how it... So, for example, that's a good question. So, and it's good for the split coil sound, that kind of thing.
Well, the more
flexible
it is as an instrument. You know,
yeah, it's actually, absolutely. It's more versatile. So check that out, that same little line or whatever. If I flip this switch, so again, here it is. Oh, sorry. So that's it with it, you know, in regular humbucker mode. Now, when I flip this, you'll hear a little snap. See how much more snappy it is? To me, I love that tone. You got Japanese guys can close your ears, but I love a Fender Stratocaster. Absolutely love it. So I love the sound of it. I love the sound of a Telecaster. I love that snappy sort of tone. I'm from the South in the U.S., so country music, bluegrass music is very popular, and it's ingrained itself into my DNA as well. So I like that sound. And as you were saying, you know, it's really good for sort of finger picking type stuff, but, you know, I'm not good at this style. Allows you to simulate that sound, right, without having to take your guitar off and pick up a Fender Stratocaster and get in trouble with the Japanese guys for playing a Fender Stratocaster, right? So this allows you to get that sound, and it does a pretty nice job of it, right? It's great for sort of the hybrid picking, something like a...
Thank you.
You know, it kind of gives you that, again, that's not my style of playing, but it gives you that kind of sound. It gives you the versatility to be able to play some stuff like that with the same guitar, which is really cool. And for somebody like me who plays in a band where we sort of pride ourselves on pushing the envelope as far as genres, we're not afraid to mix a little bit of everything in there, sort of the kitchen sink of metal bands, sort of everything. But it allows me to get all of that basically with one guitar. Oh man, we've got a mess over here. So anyway, it gives you the opportunity to sort of have all these sounds in one box. And the beauty of it is with today's amplifiers that they're making now, whether you use a modeling amp or a tube amp or whatever the case may be, amps are becoming more versatile. You know, clean channels are sounding great. They're making more amps. I mean, Black Star is a prime example. They're making amps that are great high gain sounds. They also have a killer clean sound. So you're getting more and more often you're seeing amps with a lot more diversity. And so if you can find a guitar with that same type of versatility, you're in business. You know, you can really play whatever type of music you're into. If you want to start a band that plays heavy metal and country music at the same time, you can really do that. So it's pretty awesome. So I'll shut up for a while and maybe play. Is that cool if I shut up for a while? And maybe play another song. How would that be?
Yeah, I enjoyed it. Very good.
Okay.
I've got to pay some money and put four tires on the car, so I can't.
I
really enjoyed it.
So okay, thank you very much. I appreciate it. Take care. Okay, so let's I'm rocking and rolling. Let's play a song. This one's called Famine Wolf, and this one's a little bit more technical, so this might appeal to some of the more heavy metal guys.